Hello and welcome back. This is Ibrahim Qureshi here. Welcome back to VMware Tutorial for Beginners. This is session 4 and I'm going to talk about vCenter Server 6.7 in this session today. Let's get started. I just want to briefly cover, if you're new to this channel, who is this training for? Anyone who wants to learn virtualization, no IT background or experience is required to learn this, because I'm going to take you from the basics, and you'll enjoy learning this as much. I hope you enjoy learning this as much as I enjoy delivering this course to you. As I said, no prerequisite is required. I will put a link for the other videos, which are from session 1 to 3. This is going to be the session 4. So make sure you watch those videos. Comment on below on my videos and let me know whether you are, obviously, whether you're following it or you want things in more detail, etc. Thanks. So let's get cracking. So this is the agenda. The agenda is available on SlideShare at Ibrahim SlideShare/IbrahimQureshi, which shows everything I'm going to cover in this video series for VMware for Beginners. And also, don't forget that you will find anything which new which you're going to learn here, you'll find it available on my blog. Today we are going to cover vCenter Server. I'll obviously blog about how to install vCenter Server hopefully today, and then by the time this video is online, you'll be able to obviously go there, and if you're having any problems while installing, you can always go to my blog and follow the sequential steps from there. So what has been completed so far? Obviously, in the session 1, if you are new, make sure you go and have a look at the session 1. We covered what is virtualization. Again, that's taken from basics. So I have covered type 1 and type 2 virtualization, like hypervisors. And on session 2, we covered what is cloud, different models of cloud, which is infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. We also briefly covered what is private, public, and hybrid cloud. In the last video, in session 3, we covered a little bit of what is shared storage. Remember, storage is and network is tightly coupled with virtualization, which is specifically VMware virtualization. So obviously, make sure you watch the videos from the beginning if you are new to it. In the previous videos, we covered installing the VMware vSphere 6.7. I showed you how to download it from the VMware website and install it. We connected to the ESX host. We also connected the ESX host eventually to the vCenter server. So in today's session 4, we are going to cover vCenter server. So there's a concept called, in the vCenter server, there's a service called Platform Services Controller. So we are going to cover that today. We have two types of installation essentially with vCenter server. One is with embedded PSC and the other one is external PSC. Which is external platform services controller. So we are going to cover that, then I'm going to show you how to download the vCenter server, and then we are going to learn how to install it. So that's the agenda for today. Okay, so what's VMware platform services controller? Platform services controller was actually introduced in with vCenter 6.0. The platform services controller is responsible for the following infrastructure security functions. vCenter single sign-on, so it's responsible for that, licensing and certificate management. So if you have an external PSC, you will, when you are trying to log into the vCenter, you will see that it's pointed to it will be pointed to the PSC first, and the PSC, the platform services controller, is responsible for the signing in, and then it's once you sign in, it will be redirect it back to the vCenter server. And obviously you'll see it if it's an external PSC. So types of deployment, you have a Windows vCenter server and a Linux based vCenter server. The Linux one is the VCSA, which is vCenter Server Appliance, which is a Photon OS. Photos I have written, apologies for that. That's Photon OS, which is basically Linux-based OS, which is made by VMware specifically for VMware products like vCenter Server and PSE and other things. So the first deployment type, or obviously depending on your requirement, I would say you would choose whether to have an embedded deployment of PSE or external. So vCenter Server with embedded platform services looks a little bit like this, which we have here. In the VM itself, you have the vCenter Server and the platform services controller running within the same VM. In the external deployment, what we'll see normally is, I need to draw it here. So you have your PSC. I'll do a quick one again. So you have your PSC. Which is going to be first deployed on a virtual machine. And then once the PSC is deployed, then you will deploy the vCenter server. So you have the vCenter server as a VM. So this is an example of external PSC. So as you can see, when you connect to the vCenter, it will, for authentication, it will basically redirect it to the PSC, and the PSC authenticates using SSO, which is single sign-on. And then once you have been authenticated, you will be redirect back to the vCenter server, something like that. Of course, the PSC is responsible for other elements, as I discussed, like the licensing and the configuration side, which I have mentioned here, licensing and certificate management, sorry. And there's a little bit more services with the PSC take care, but for now let's keep things simple. The important element which the PSC is responsible for is vCenter server, single sign-on, licensing and certificate management. Okay, so when we deploy, the deployment are in different types now. So you will see that when we are deploying, it will ask you whether you want a tiny or a small or medium, large or extra large. What that actually refers to is, if you have a tiny instance and if you deploy a tiny instance, you will be able to have up to 10 hosts connected only, and you can only run up to 100 VMs. Again, I would say if you're having a test lab or something, or you're having a home lab where you know you're not going to exceed 100 VMs and 10 hosts, then this is the perfect one. Also, you need to look at how much CPU and memory the vCenter itself will consume. So it will require 2 vCPUs and 10 gig memory, which is a lot. Imagine for me, I'm running a home lab on a single ESX host with 32 gig memory. That's 10 gig gone just for the vCenter itself. So it can be chewy, really. And the vCenter is a robust product, which is designed to manage and multiple hosts and thousands of VMs. So if you are in a production environment and you know you are not going to exceed 100, then go for small. Or if you know that you are going to exceed more than 100, then I would say at least go for medium. In that way, you know you are going to be having a capacity of, adding up to 400 hosts, and you can have a capacity of up to 4,000 VMs. The large instance, on the other hand, can manage up to 1,000 hosts and 10,000 VMs. The extra large one, obviously, as the slide is saying, 2,000 hosts and 35,000 VMs. But at the same time, look at the requirement of the virtual machine itself. So you can see that it needs 24 vCPUs and 48 gig memory. For large, it is 16 CPUs and 32 gig memory. And for and small needs for CPUs and 16 gig memory, so on and so forth, as we can see here. So let's get to the next one. So installing, when you're installing, obviously we'll go through the process of obviously how to obviously Google search it and all that, but the, essentially when you deploy launch it, the installer, you'll find four options. I briefly want to cover these options. Install a new virtual, so the install feature is for installing a fresh installation. The upgrade option, which you can see here, is when you have 6.0 running or 6.5 running in your environment and you want to upgrade it from either 6.0 or 6.5 to 6.7. Migrate is when you're actually migrating it from a Windows vCenter server. It could be a 6.0, it could be a 6.5. So that's when you're going to use a migrate option. Restore is when you have a corrupted version of vCenter and you want to obviously restore it. Okay, before we start installing it, as I was discussing the CPU, the CPU and memory sizes for the requirement for the vCenter and how much maximum host you can support when you have a tiny instance and medium instance, how many number of virtual machine you can install. It's a really good website VMware has created. It's called configmax.vmware.com. So if you go on there, you have two options. You can view the limits, which is the maximum limits for each version which you are having. Say for example, I have a vCenter server 6.0 and I want to see how many virtual machines it can, you know, I can deploy, maximum number of virtual machines I can deploy, or how many LANs can be supported or data stores can be supported for ESXi Host. So maximum number of data stores supported in version 6, I think, or 5.5 was 256. Now that limit has increased to 512. So those sort of things. And also you have view limits or compare limits. When I say compare limits, you can have comparison with different versions. I have put here vSphere 6.7, 6 and 6.5 update 1. And you can compare what are the differences you can see here. Okay. So before I start the installation, let's quickly go. This is the slide, share.net/Ibrahim Qureshi, which I was talking about. You can find the agenda from the beginning, what I'm covering in this topic. So we have covered vCenter, we have covered everything till here. We are going to cover, understand the VMware 6.7, VMware vCenter 6.7 PSC embedded and separate PSCs, which is external PSC. So today we are here, and we are now going to do install the installation process of vCenter server. So let's get started. I think I have another browser open here somewhere. So this is the VMware maximum, config maximum.vmware website, which I talked about. So we can click on this website, we can view maximums and view limits, click on view limits, and then we can click vSphere, and then it will show you compute maximum virtual CPUs. See, so as you're learning more about VMware, you need to start adapting how to search for what you need to know. And obviously as a virtualization admin, you need to know what is the maximum limit, what is the minimum limit, and also always try to be within the maximum limit so that you don't get, you know, issues going forward. So like persistent memory 1024, so these are the maximum limit for this. Okay, so let's get started. So I'm just refresh, hopefully. Yeah, it's good. So basically I'm quickly going to show you, we are going to search on Google, download, instead of ESX 6.7 we are going to say vCenter 6.7, which is what we have here, and then we'll go to the vCenter server page, and then it will say This is the vCenter. Click on download. Need to put in the details in again. Need to use my personal one. Here we are on the download page. It's grayed out for me, but you need to click on download trial and then you'll be able to download it. So download vCenter server. We downloaded ESX bundles before. Expand the vCenter server and then you click on manual download. I have downloaded the vCenter server just now, so I'm not going to download it again, but if you click on it, it will ask where you want to download and then you just say download. Okay, so I'm just going to cancel it, but what I would say is I have downloaded it here in temp. This is the vCenter server, vCSA, vCenter server appliance. So what we normally do is we right click once you downloaded it and you mount the disk. When you mount the disk, then you'll see it open. In this, you'll see the UI, user interface installer. You go in Windows 32 and then at the bottom you'll find the installer. So to install this, you have to double click on the installer. I have got some feedback saying that people are procrastinating because the videos are gone over 20 minutes. So I'm going to cut this video short. We'll go through the installation in the next video. We'll complete the installation in the next video. What I would say is, so we have successfully saw the components which vCenter server needs, the PSE, the options with embedded installation and without, with the separate PSE as well. I will continue the installation in the next video. I would say if you have any question, reach out to me on Twitter at Ibrahim Qureshi. Follow my blog as well, and don't forget to subscribe my YouTube channel and share it with your friends. And the question of the day for you guys is, what is the PSE used for, the main purpose of PSE? I have covered the main purpose of the PSE. There are more than one purpose, but obviously if you can get at least one or two right, leave them on the comments below, and I will respond to you. Okay then, thanks, bye.